Hi, I'm Yashika Ghai.
I'm Monica Gehrig.
Hi, I'm Zeke Unterberg.
My name is Joy Fan.
Hi, I'm Arnie Lumsdane.
Mr. Fusion, Back to the Future 2.
Wait a minute, what are you doing, Doc?
I need fuel. Go ahead, quick, get in the car.
For the era I came up in, I guess I'm a late Gen Xer. Mr. Fusion was where we saw fusion for the first time.
Well, that was interesting. I wish there was a fusion reactor that we can create by just putting, you know, trash into it and just produce energy. But I don't think that's possible. That's, unfortunately, it's not true.
Throwing banana peels and beer into a chamber and then closing it and saying that's giving you time travel. I mean, it's interesting. Will we ever get to energy generation that with fusion in that way? I'm not so sure.
Maybe in some future device you could use, you know, you could extract hydrogen from some of these organic compounds in the waste and, you know, use hydrogen as fuel in this. But the overwhelming thing is just how small and compact this device is. And there seems to be no shielding around it whatsoever. So neutrons are going to be flying out everywhere. So that'd be a little bit concerning.
So in terms of what produces the plasma, generally deuterium and tritium, which are isotopes of hydrogen. So hydrogen is a proton and an electron. Deuterium is a proton with a neutron with an electron. And tritium is proton and two neutrons.
Yeah, so for the fuel we use in fusion reactor, it's usually the cryogenic hydrogen isotope. And we will make them to form a type of like pellets or like small pieces under very cold temperature, like 7K, 13K, etc. Then we will just squeeze them, extrude them into small pellets, just like we squeeze our toothpaste each morning. And all the toothpaste you squeezed onto your toothbrush would actually be the small pieces we are going to be shoot into the fusion reactor. And the device to shoot them is like a machine gun design, so we can guarantee a really large amount of hydrogen isotope being shot into fusion reactor to provide a continuous fuel.
If you pass by a large power plant, that's what's producing about a gigawatt. And while fusion will tend to minimize, fusion has a much higher energy density than what you have with coal, but still the types of infrastructure you need, the magnets or the lasers or whatever that'll be producing fusion, is still gonna have a fairly large footprint and will require a power plant.
1.21 gigawatts is actually a lot of power. So the experiments that we'll be performing next in this ITER device, which is being built in France, and this ITER device is of the size of a 10-story tall building, and the fusion power that it's supposed to generate is about 500 megawatts, and that too with an input of 50 megawatt. So we are only generating 10 times the output power as compared to the input power. So 1.21 gigawatts, we can probably think of maybe in a fusion reactor, in a future reactor-level fusion device, but not in a near future.
You would be making, at that scale, with what we know today, microwatts to nanowatts of energy, which means it would take a lot more energy to go into getting those two atoms to combine than what they are spitting back out.
It's kind of like too small, and also considering the environment, which in this video clip is like room temperature, it's not gonna happen in the fusion reactor, which has like really high temperature, maybe 10 times of the sun.
One thing that would be very difficult would be heat removal, because if it is that small, you're gonna have a really, really high power density, and so you would need to have just the most robust heat-tolerant materials imaginable.